Sound design.
So how do I measure an EQ and how do I make sure that I'm actually getting good data? So first let's check our physical routing, our digital routing, make sure that we've got our measurement set up correctly, and then look at the results. Okay, so looking over here at my audio interface, this is what we have from before, right? I've got my reference input coming from the back of the X32. And I've got my measurement microphone in here. So if we want to measure the X32, then I'm going to need to take a post EQ, right? So I'm going to have a reference here that is pre-EQ, and then I need something else to measure it against. So that'll be post EQ. And so I'll put my EQ in the middle, and that'll be my device under test. So the reference will come before the EQ, and then I'll have the EQ in the middle, device under test, and then post EQ, that'll go into this third input that I have open here. So I'm using this output already. So I got another TRS to TRS cable here, and I'm just gonna use the next input up. So here is, I'm sorry, did I say input? I meant output. So here's output 5 on the X32. And I'm going to take the other end of that and I'll plug that into my third input here on my audio interface. Okay, so that's the physical patching and you can see here that on inputs 1 and 3 here that I'm using, they have the exact same settings, okay? Gains all the way down, none of these buttons pushed in. So let's look at the X32. Let's go to routing. And here, let's take a look at the aux outputs, this tab here. And now, output 6, you remember from my previous videos that this is a pre-everything, pre-EQ, pre-fader output from matrix 1. So everything's coming out of matrix 1. It's just that I've just hooked up a new one out of output 5, aux out 5, that is post EQ. So output 6, pre-EQ, output 5, post EQ, and I know it's hard to see, but this is purple, and this is red, and I've got this legend down here. So that's how I know what's going on. So let's take a look at in Smaart and see if that's actually set up correctly. So we'll hit play on my, oh, I should show you how I created this. So on my inputs here, I changed the name of input 3 to X32 post. So that would be clear to me. And then under measurement config, my third measurement is now called X32. I'm measuring the X32. And I set my measurement signal to X32 post. And my reference signal to reference. So let's just look at ref first. Turn on the generator. Okay, so I'm getting the reference. Let's hit play on the X32. Okay, they're already pretty much matched in level. That's great. Now let's see if I manipulate the EQ. When I manipulate the EQ, I should see a change in my X32 measurement, this purple one, post EQ, but no change in my reference, the pre EQ. So I'll just grab one of these and I'll pull it down. Okay, this is what we wanted to see, right? We've got a cut here in the purple guy, post EQ, but none in the green. Now, if I had done this wrong, I'll open up routing again. If I had done this wrong, and let's say that this one was also pre-EQ, then we see no change here, right? But output 5 is post fader, post EQ, post everything. So we see the EQ change there. All right, so I'll reset the EQ. And it might just be interesting to see if we're totally matched in level. So let's switch to assign. And here will just be a quick piece of trivia. We see a big peak here, but then what are these little peaks? And as we go farther, closer to the noise floor, there's even more of them. So if you know what this is, what are these peaks? Comment below this video and we'll see who gets it first. 200 hertz, where we expect it to be, because that's where the signal generator is, right? 400, 600, what do you think the next one's gonna be? 800. We were gonna check and see if we were completely matched here. And we are. I'm gonna call that completely matched. Okay, we could be super picky if we want to. Can we get any closer? Probably not. All right, I'll just leave it where it was. Cool, so let's head over to our transfer function. And let's talk about what we expect to see before I turn this on. I'm expecting this to be almost exactly like the microphone cable, right? I expect to see in the IR response here, just a quick up and down. It should just be boop, boop. You know, there's no sound coming out of speakers or traveling through air, so it should be all frequencies up and down. In the magnitude response here, I expect to see a completely flat line, 100% coherence. In the phase response, same thing, completely flat line. All completely boring. This is what I expect to see, just measuring EQ where everything's completely flat, right? This EQ, I just reset it. In the channel configuration, no insert yet. All right, so let's hit play on this. X32, we'll hit go on my analyzer. Whoa. All right, this is not what I expected to see. Okay, I remember the problem from last time. Okay, I forgot to chain this back to pink noise, right? Okay, now why do I have all these weird wraparounds here? Okay, I remember from last time, I can also see up here that this delay is not right where it's supposed to be. So it must be because this delay is wrong. So let me hit delay tracking. It goes to zero. Okay. Everything flattens out. Now my expectations have come true, right? So flat, flat, flat. Just a quick blip here, up and down. Great. Now we can actually start manipulating the EQ and seeing what that looks like. Sort of the picture of the shapes that EQ make in my mind are what they really make on an analyzer. When I can start connecting those things, then I can start having trust in the analyzer and I can start working more quickly. So just for example, if we go back to the EQ here, and let me turn off this spectrum thing because it's kind of distracting. RTA. So now my question is, if I make this kind of a shape with an EQ, and it looks like this on this graphic display, and I have in my mind, okay, that's what the shape is, then over here in Smaart, in the amplitude display here, is that the shape? Yeah, they look very similar, right? So then I can play around with this, and I start getting some ideas for what these shapes are. And I can take a look, what's the difference between PEQ and VEQ? Did I choose the wrong one? Yes. PEQ and VEQ. Okay. And is it the same thing when I boost and when I cut? VEQ and PEQ. And I can make this go a little bit faster because, again, we're not measuring a room with air, so everything can be faster. Look at that. Okay, good. What about a low shelf? And I can also then observe the effects of what's happening with phase. Okay, and again, I'm not talking about any of the theory about why this is happening. With these first steps, I'm just suggesting that you don't change anything. Just start getting used to what the graph looks like, what things are, what things look like when you measure them, what changes look like when you measure them. And so now we're just observing. When I measure an EQ, when I make changes, what does that look like in the magnitude trace here? What does that look like in the phase trace here, okay? An important thing to note here about the EQ is that if I turn it off and on, no delay changes. Okay, so if I hit delay here again, still zero. If I go back here and turn on the EQ, so turning on the channel EQ doesn't seem to have an effect on the delay. But if I go over here, let me reset this first. If I go over here to the insert and put that in, okay, look at this. Change of phase display. I've got some coherence problems up here. I know this is the delay problem. And I can also see the impulse response up here has gone back a little bit. So I'll turn on delay tracking. Okay, great. Everything's gone back to flat. And now I can see that when I put in an insert like that, it adds 0.67 milliseconds of delay, just round trip through the X32, okay? So this little bit of extra processing here, I need to keep in mind. And this is why you can't just do parallel processing of drums, for example, where you send one to your compressor and back again. You have to send both through the same signal chain so that they both have the same amount of delay. Okay, just this is just a thing in the X32. It's a thing you have to keep in mind with a lot of digital consoles. Okay, so let's take a look at that graphic EQ. For a long time, I think probably, I don't know, the first 10 years of being a sound engineer, this was my main tool. You show up at a gig, and this is the first thing you want to use to do your sound system tuning, to do your ringing out of stage monitors, to do your ringing out of the system. It's a really powerful tool, right? It's right in front of you. You've got all these things you can grab. And I'll tell you, for a long time, I thought that these were really surgical tools, right? I thought that if I just grab this and like, boom, pull it down, that's like an ice pick, right? And then just killing that one frequency. So let's see what that actually looks like. I feel like everyone should do this, because it wasn't until I actually did this exercise myself that I found, oh, maybe graphic EQs aren't really doing what I thought they do. And again, this is just a good exercise to connect what I think is happening in my mind to what is actually happening when it's measured. Okay, I know that this speaker normally doesn't sound so great around the crossover between the low frequency driver and the high frequency driver. So I might pull this down a little bit, and I'll pull both of these down a little bit like that, okay? And I know that I want a little low-end boost for that hi-fi sound. So I'll turn all of these up a bit. Especially at 50, that's a good frequency, right? Okay, great. This is like the Nathan Lively curve, all right? This is gonna give you that hi-fi sound. You know, let's add a little bit of sparkle on top. That's going to sound good, but I don't want to feed back, so I'm not going to turn it up too much. All right, so this is where I might start. This is just like the curve I always start with on a graphic EQ. And then I might say, okay, let's ring out the system. Okay, so I start it up, I'm like, oh, it's ringing at 8K, just kill that frequency. Oh, you know what? It turns out it's not 8K. It's like between 6K and 8K, so I need to bring down 6K a little bit too, because it's in between there. Okay. Where's the next frequency that's gonna ring out? Oh, we've got some low end buildup. Okay, so I need to kill 500. And you know what's actually between 500 and 630 somehow, so I need to bring this one down too. Okay, so I might do some work like that. And so far, this is not a crazy looking EQ. This is the kind of EQ setting you might see going into any concert venue, right? And any sound engineer, this is not necessarily embarrassing, right? I'm not gonna say anything to anyone who's using this. Okay. What I think most people don't realize, and what I didn't realize for a long time, is what this really looks like. I feel like I'm doing this gentle thing here and like these really specific cuts here. Now, if I bring this down and we take a look at what's actually happening on the measurement here, wow, this is not quite what I thought it was. First of all, these cuts are not as surgical as I thought they were. They sort of like gang together, right? And also, this is not as smooth as I thought it was. It's like these little sawtooth things. So I think when I see this, I start realizing this is not a great tool for sound system optimization. Number one, I can't put filters exactly where I need them, because I kept having these moments where I was like, you know what, it's between 8K and 6K, but I can't put an exact filter there. And I can never get the filter to be the width I want it to be. Here, it's not narrow enough. Down here, I want it to be more wide, but it's fixed bandwidth, okay? Plus, then ganging up these filters, I have this weird stuff going on with the phase. I don't know what this is. Plus, it does kind of a weird thing to the impulse response up here. I'll just show you. Now, if we go back to this and I reset all of these. Okay, here's what the impulse response should look like before I added all this stuff. Okay. If you want to keep using graphic EQs, please be my guest. I know they still show up all the time. I just want you to be aware of what's happening. When you know what's happening, like, that's the power, okay? At least you know what's going on, and in your head you can be like, okay, it's always a balance of compromises, right? Balance of compromises. One more thing I want to tell you about the graphic EQ as related to smoothing. This is another great test for you to do on your own. Let's say that we do a boost here. Okay, I've got my locked cursor here. And what does this say in the white here? It says 500 Hertz, 15 dB. Okay. Yep. 500 Hertz, 15 dB. That's what we've got on our graphic EQ. So far here, it looks like we're looking at the truth, right? And I learned this from Mauricio Ramirez, and this is why he says when you use smoothing, you're looking at lies. Because if I switch the magnitude smoothing here to 1/3 octave, whoa, this goes down from, look here at the white numbers, I can't put my cursor up there. It goes from 15 to 11. Maybe that's not a huge change, but all of a sudden, we're looking at a lie. This is not, we should be looking at a 15 dB boost, but with the smoothing all the way down to 1/3 octave like that, maybe the picture looks better, but it's not really a truth anymore, and it's not quite helping us. You notice that the filter also got wider here. So let me just show you the change one more time again. Here's 1/48. And here's 1/3 octave smoothing. Okay, so just keep these things in mind. Again, you just want to know what the tools are doing so you're not sort of just using them in a haphazard manner. And these really basic methods of measuring things under control and just taking little steps are what give us confidence in the tools. Okay, so that was measuring an EQ. Sorry this was so long, but like taking these initial little steps, I don't want anyone to be left behind or have too many unanswered questions. I'm sure you have some questions though from watching this video. Please post them below the video, and I would love to get into them with you and have more conversation about this stuff. Let's just recap again real quick what we learned. So measuring this EQ, if I want to measure EQ, I need a pre-EQ tap and a post-EQ tap, and that's my reference and my measurement signal into my audio analyzer. And then the thing I expected to see was, you know, when everything is flat, let me go back here, reset this. What I expected to see was totally flat, and when there was no insert in, I expected to see little to no delay, and then when I put the insert in, I expected to see a little bit of delay. Okay, so expectations validated.
Sound design. Live.